Okay, so I will be speaking about anomalies. It's a completely new task for today. Okay, unlike the previous lecturers, I will be speaking about anomalies, about models that are good enough, basically. Okay, so most of you, I suppose, are highly professional people, and you strive to create as good model as you can, right? Raise your hand if it's correct. Thank you. Sometimes, however, you build your model and you are very happy about it, but your boss or your customer or client, they just don't care. Raise your hand if it happened to you. Okay. I suspect that you are liars. So what I will be telling you today is a story. It's not a, you know, regular talk with methods and results and stuff like that. It's a story. Like any story, I will have some introduction, you will see some plot twists, and there will be a happy ending. Okay? And this presentation is based on a true story for dramatic purposes and to make me look better. Some stuff are modified. So it's not completely true, it's based on truth. Okay? Okay, I work at Automatic. Automatic is the company that builds many cool projects like WordPress.com, Jetpack, WooCommerce, Longgrid, stuff like that. Our biggest project is WordPress.com. We host, I think, 120 million users with this crazy amount of posts written. It's a nice company to work at. One of the interesting things about Automatic is that we are a distributed company. That means that everybody works from their homes, the coffee shops, whenever they want. And the company has now more than 500 people. Data science team alone is spread over 4 continents today, from Australia, Israel, Europe, and the States. From time to time we meet. So this is a picture from one of our meetings in Berlin. And when we meet, we discuss ideas. So we rented an East German apartment, and we used it to discuss stuff and to have a good time. And one of the discussions was about this dashboard. So like many companies, we have an internal dashboard that monitors all the money that the company has, okay? So we can see the global cash sales and average sales and the churn rates and stuff like that. And this is Carly, she's a data science team lead, and she told me, you know, Stu, the chief financial officer, wants us to do some data magic on this data, on this dashboard, because right now, there is a dashboard and that's it. And they said, well, we'll do anomaly detection time series. That's it, as simple as that. And everybody, of course, told me, you know, it's not that simple, right? Because time series and anomaly detection are complex. And they said, yes, it is simple. And they told me, well, you're kidding, right? And I told, no. It's a solved problem, an intern can do it. I actually said that. So at some point, Carly told me, you know what, if you think it's a solved problem, take it and solve it. And then I said, uh-oh. Right? Because it's easier to say, give it to an intern and then solving it by yourself. But so there I was, in a deep, deep trouble. Because time series is a tough problem. So this is an example of very simple time series, right? A sine wave. And this is an example of slightly more complicated one. We have a sine wave that rides on a trend. A little bit more complicated. And now we have two periods. We have the larger period and the smaller period, right? So if you think about, let's say, sales, you can see some daily fluctuations and some fluctuations over the week, okay? And there's a completely different type of time series of a binary time series. Let's say it's my heart rate, tuck, tuck, tuck. It's a completely different type of data and completely different type of analysis. And of course, the crazy stuff like this. This is a ECG, electrocardiograph. So, and there is much more examples that I've shown you. So, yeah, time series is a tough problem. Not only that, there are many other problems that sit above the staff problem, like malicious users and multiple seasonalities, spikes and drops, over and under saturation, and error costs. A lot of problems. So if you ask me, I think that the biggest problem of all the models, actually, is this one, the error cost. Because errors are painful. Let's say you are an analyst in PayPal. Where is he? David? Okay. So you have a big customer and you think that there's some money laundering on the customer, you shut down the account. The customer is angry. The customer leaves the company. Actually, nobody can leave PayPal, but okay. And your management is angry and you get fired. So this is an error cost. In my case, and the CFO doesn't like me that I say this, the error cost is pretty close to zero. Why is that? Because all I intend to do is just to send some alert to a business person. Worst case scenario, somebody will waste 10 minutes of their time to inspect this alert. That's it. If I do my work very bad, they will receive too many alerts and will just ignore all of the alerts. But overall, the error cost is not a big deal in my case. So I strike it out. What about sudden spikes and drops? So I work in a pretty big company, and fortunately we have a very steady stream of data, of money, because it's a dashboard that counts money. So everything is pretty smooth and stable. And the purchases are not affected by any external events. Okay, so in my cases, we don't have too many drops and we don't have too many spikes. Moreover, in my case, these are not the bugs, but the features that I'm looking for. So I'm just striking these two problems away, too. What about oversaturation and undersaturation? If you deal with measurement equipment, where is Ari? Okay. If you deal with measurement equipment, you know that measurement equipment can oversaturate or undersaturate. You are counting money. I mean, it's very hard to oversaturate money, right? So, not a problem. What about malicious users? Well, this is a tough one, but I think that I can ignore them at this point because I'm looking at aggregated data of the company and I don't think that malicious users will be that smart to dig into the dashboard and to tackle with it. So I'm just deleting these two. So I'm left with two problems, multiple seasonality and concept drift. Multiple seasonality, you already saw this this example, so you have one shorter cycle and one longer cycle. And the concept drift is another big problem in machine learning where you have some gradual change in behavior. And when it happens, you know that you need to retrain your data. Okay? I solve both these problems using a very simple approach. I just ignore most of the history. I'm just looking at the very short window of my data. Am I losing information? Of course I am. Can I do better? Of course I can. Is it good enough? Yeah, it's good enough. Okay, so, well, I told you an intern can do it. The only thing that I need to do is just to have some data, to fit a model, to compute the residuals, to define some thresholds, and to mark the anomalies, that's it. As simple as that, right? I mean, and we have all these models already implemented in open source libraries. ARIMA, Fast Fourier Transform, Markov models, neural networks, well, you name it. So what you do when you want to study how to model a time series, you open, look for tutorials, And this is the first model that appears in 90% of all the tutorials, right? ARIMA. ARIMA has some one component for the trend, for non-seasonal part, and one component for seasonalities. And once you have this equation, you have your data, you fit the parameters, and you have the model. As simple as this. So now I have the ladder to take me out of the hole that I dig to myself. Not that simple. It turns out that ARIMA assumes a lot of assumptions about the data. So you have to pre-process the data. If you don't do it right, the parameter fitting doesn't go well, and it doesn't converge, or it just results in a gibberish. So you have to iterate over this process a couple of times. So initially I thought, well, we have a dozen of metrics in our dashboard. So I can repeat this problem, this process for 10 times, maybe 12 times, not a big deal. What I didn't know was that, yes, we had about of dozens of metrics, but every metric can be split into different business units. And every metric split at every business unit can also be split at multiple geographical areas, okay? So now, instead of fitting a dozen of models, I need to fit 1,000 of models. And it's not fun. I mean, not even for interns. Any interns here? No. Okay. So yeah, I at some point I realized that the hole was deeper than I thought. But then I was actually lucky. I found this cool library. It's called Seasonal. Yeah. And what it does, it takes some data and it separates the seasonal part and the non-seasonal part. And it does it using a very robust algorithm that assumes almost no assumptions about the data. Okay, it is very robust. How robust? Using a single configuration setting, I was able to create a meaningful model for all the hundreds of models that I tested without any need to repeat an iteration. That robust. So all I had to do was to write some Python code, to create a IPython presentation using real data, and you can see I was able to detect some anomalies, and that's it. Ah, and to find the catchy name. So my name was A2F2, anomaly analysis and future forecast. Because once you have a model that that models the data, you can forecast the future, right? And all the process, from the assignment to the IPython presentation, 1 week. Okay? Thanks to the good enough approach. The problem was, nobody cared. I mean, I cared, but no, nobody cared. And that's when I realized that the ladder that I built wasn't tall enough, and they had to do much more. So the first thing that I did was to take Bokeh. It's an open source visualization library that allows you to create interactive graphs using pure Python. And so I created an interactive thing. And I was sure that when people would start playing with the data and will see some anomalies and future forecast and stuff like that, everybody will buy my model, right? No. So I recorded a video demo. Because we are a distributed company, I cannot tell everybody, come to my office, I will show you something, right? I recorded the video and I sent the video to everybody. And no. So then for the first time in my life, I decided I will build a REST API, because most of the programmers in our company are PHP developers, okay? So I thought I will build a server, and they will interface with my server, and then everybody will be happy. So I took Bottle and built a REST API. It took me some time. I was happy. Nobody cared. So then I decided, you know, if I'm detecting anomalies, I should push the anomalies to the customers, right? It's like saying, hey, something strange is happening here. So I decided I will design a push service. Okay? Some more coding, this time PHP. I hate PHP. And I had a periodic job that analyzes the data and pushes the alerts to relevant people in the company. Okay, so I thought that nobody cared. But then there was a bug in my program. Sometimes I write programs with bugs, okay? Don't judge me. And then the CFO pings me on Slack and says, hey, Boris, is A2F2 offline? I haven't gotten any alerts for a few days. I can't live without my alerts. And I was, it's the CFO, right? Yeah, it's real. So I was a little bit more optimistic. And a couple of days later, he pinged another channel in Slack. Scorecard Alerts just sent me a Slack message flagging today's rule renewals as anomaly. I think this is an impact of this and that. So not only did he notice the alert, and he thought that the alert was relevant, the alert was also connected to an actual event in the business of the company. And remind you, this is a very simple model, only good enough to make people notice stuff, right? So that was 2 weeks ago. As of today, we have 11 users. It's 2% of the company. It's quite a lot, actually. But I also know that this project will not be shelved and put aside. So I know that this project has a future, and the future is actually a very bright future. Okay? So, but the interesting thing is that the modeling part took 1 week. It was simple enough, good enough, but 1 week. This part, the visualization, building the web API, push notification, debugging, and me learning to do this stuff took, I think, 3 months. Okay? And only now, it's 90% of the effort is non-data science effort. But only due to this non-data science effort am I able now to spend more time to create better models for, I don't know, using better, more complicated methods and more create more accurate models. And for me, it was sort of epiphany. Because we all know about the minimal viable product concept in programming, but not in data science. And I think it's much more important for us to remember that it's not enough to build an excellent model. First of all, you need to build a good enough solution to somebody's problems. Thank you. Questions? Yes.
So how many bugs have you fixed since you have users?
Only one bug. That's it. Usually I don't write bugs, but I had to. So the question is, how much effort did they invest into building the product around the model?
Like envisioning how the model would serve the users.
Envisioning how the model would serve the users. Actually, not too much. I mean, I had an idea what I would like to see, what I would like this product to be. At some point, the CFO was very eager to help me to redefine, for example, the wording of the alerts. What is actually written in the alerts? So, and he knows about business better than I do. So, yeah, so I hope this answered the question. I mean, we had several iterations with the business people about how this the results will be consumed. Yeah. Yes. So the question is whether I want to make a product of this framework. Yeah. Yes. Yes. Actually, I even think of not selling, opening the source. Right now, some portions of the code are very tightly connected to the dashboard, internal dashboard terminology. But once I have time, the plan is to open the source of this thing. Thank you.